I'm the research director at Vésale Bioscience and also a former student of Rob Levine's. I did my PhD in his laboratory. Oh, so I'm now working from a more commercial and more medical and more routine perspective now with phage, at working to develop them as wild phage, the phage itself, as a therapy, so as to ideally create a sustainable solution to the antimicrobial resistance crisis. So in this report today, I'm going to talk about our global challenge with antimicrobial resistance and what's coming, as well as the different models for phage therapy, the different ways this could be made to work, evidence for efficacy, and what we do as a company, what our strategy is for phage therapy. Let's see. I think my slides might be, here we go, frozen. There, I've got it now. So just to introduce the world that we have now, I'd like to introduce the world that antibiotics have made, where we live in a world that has only been possible to create with antibiotics. A century ago, in 1900, the vast majority of somewhere around half of deaths were due to infectious disease, recently in 2010, that only represents a very small fraction of the deaths of annual mortality today. The difference between these two graphs is massive. We now die globally around the age of 70 or 80, rather than much, much younger during the prime of life, the prime of working life, allowing the modern world to really exist. This also hides a great deal of benefit that being able to address infectious disease with antibiotics has created, where as a result of being able to treat a patient during, say, a heart surgery with antibiotics, many more heart surgeries are safe and effective and allow people who would otherwise die of a heart attack to then go on to live healthy, productive lives, see their grandchildren. In a way that would not have been possible without antibiotics. But now with antibiotic resistance, we're slowly returning to that era. Where the thing that antibiotics really did is they allowed us to take patients who would have otherwise died of infectious disease and allow them to live. But it's what they really did is perhaps a little bit more than that. Where we live in relationship with the bacteria that exist with us. And so for the last 100 years, we've been able to engineer a much more mutualistic relationship with our microbiota existed before antibiotics. All of a sudden, in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s, when with the advent of penicillin, when a patient had the commensal staph that lived on them and kept their skin healthy and dry and free of other pathogens, obtained a pathogenicity island, and essentially grabbing a knife and stabbing them in the back, creating a pussy wound that would allow that bacteria to, instead of being tied to that patient, instead spread to 3 to 4 of their friends, getting them sick as a result of that oozing ulcer. Change in that relationship was responsible for somewhere around 5% of deaths annually. Before the antibiotic era, staph would do hideous things to patients, to many patients. But with the advent of antibiotics, not only were we able to take these patients and save their lives, but also we were able to prevent their strains of staph from spreading to other patients, eliminating this evolutionary strategy, driving it nearly to extinction. And so not only did antibiotics allow us to treat patients, but it also allowed us to farm the bacteria, to generate that new, much more mutualistic relationship with the bacteria that exist on us, allowing them to help us rather than hurt us. No, but now with antibiotic resistance, we're losing that both abilities. Not only are we losing the ability to treat patients, to save their lives when they have bacteria that hurt them, we're also losing our ability to prevent those strains, those virulent strains, from spreading to those patients' friends. And so we are rapidly returning back to that era before 1900, when a patient had a bacterial problem that was going to kill them, and we'd be able to do very little other than pray. And so we will return back to this amount of deaths from infectious disease. Current projections for the scale of death that we can expect mediated by antimicrobial resistant bacteria is massive. It's really impossible for us in our generation to conceive. Where even in the context of a much older world that will have much more cancer, we can expect deaths from AMR to beat out cancer as the number one cause of death, with an annual mortality approaching 10 million. So for a sense of scale, that's larger than the annualized mortality due to World War II, all of World War II, in every theater, including both civilian and military deaths. This is a tragedy larger than any other humanity has ever experienced in scale. But like World War II, it will only end when we make it end or prevent it. And so at Vésale Bioscience, we feel that the need to prevent this before it comes to this scale. But also it's important to keep in mind that the impact of this mortality is not going to be evenly spread. Now, you can see here in this graph, North America and Europe will see a substantial amount of mortality, but the vast majority of these deaths are going to occur in Africa and Asia, in societies that are now lower and middle income countries that are rapidly developing and becoming wealthy countries and should be able to become wealthy countries by 2050. But if they're saddled with over 4 million deaths per year in Africa and over nearly 5 million deaths per year in Asia, that will prevent countries from becoming as wealthy as they should, as wealthy as they deserve to be, creating an issue of global justice. And so this we really see as the core issue that we'd like to be a part of solving. No, but even just looking at AMR today, and even just looking at it in Europe, it's already a massive problem and globally somewhere around 0.7 million deaths yearly. It's already a very expensive problem for hospitals to deal with. So I'm going to next present the different models for phage therapy that have been conceived over the last 100 years. This is not a new modality for addressing bacterial pathogenesis. So the story of phage therapy really starts with Felix Durrell, the man who first really described the phage, what a phage really is, first saw a plaque and understood really what that plaque was. So Felix Durrell, back in 1917, when he saw a plaque and really understood that a plaque was a phage, a virus that was self-replicating and potentially useful as a medicine, he set to work more or less right away, developing them as medicines. So some of the first applications of phage therapy were in the French mounted infantrymen during World War I, and allowing him to start developing phages as therapeutics, particularly in France, before he moved to the Soviet Union, to Tbilisi, Georgia, where he worked with George Eliava to develop really the first sustainable model for phage therapy. So this model still exists today, where in the form of entestophage and pyophage and the other products that are still sold by the Eliava Institute in Tbilisi, Georgia. And this model really is quite brilliant in its simplicity. Rob Levine introduced how phage are very specific and also induce resistance, phage-mediated phage resistance quite quickly. So Durell's solution to both of these problems together was to isolate a phage against the bacterial clinical isolate of patient and turn that into a pharmaceutical product. And then as soon as he encountered a patient that phage would not treat, he then took that phage, mixed it with, isolated a new phage against that bacterial isolate and mixed it with the original phage. To then create a new pharmaceutical product that would then work on more clinical isolates than the first. And then once he encountered a patient that new product wouldn't work against, he took their clinical isolate, isolated a new phage, and mixed it in. And this model eventually evolved into the pharmaceutical preparations that became available all over the Soviet Union in the form of entestophage and pyophage and others, where as this model became more and more institutionalized and grew, the entestophage and pyophage began to be updated every 6 to 12 months. Phages isolated against bacterial isolates collected from all over the Soviet Union and its socialist allies, creating a product, really a nearly quite global product that was able to be used quite effectively across the Soviet Union. But looking at this as a Western pharmaceutical company, there are issues with using this model in the context of Western pharmaceutical regulation, where very quickly the phages that are in this product evolve with no control, where as the phage can continue, as this product continues to be used, continues to be updated, the phages within it mutate, which might increase their efficacy as it continually gets updated on the strains that ail society. But very, very quickly you lose track of what phages are in there. And with modern pharmaceutical regulations, it is absolutely necessary for preparation for pharmaceutical products to be both pure and potent. And purity means that you need to know what's in your product. If you've lost track, that's fundamentally incompatible. And so as a company, we saw this really as a non-starter, at least for the West, at least today, as well as it may have worked. The next sort of most obvious way to model with which to create a phage therapy product would be with a cocktail. So the underlying idea would be, because a single phage is unlikely to be effective for very many patients, you collect bacterial isolates from many patients and then develop a cocktail of phage, a mixture of phage, each of which will hit will be able to replicate at the expense of their small portion of the large pie of clinical isolates. Together, they should make an effective medical product, where a patient comes in with a Pseudomonas infection, and then you have a Pseudomonas phage cocktail of 3 to 4 to 5 or 6 Pseudomonas phages all mixed together. And you then hope that at least one of those phages will be able to propagate at the expense of that patient's clinical isolate, allowing them to be effectively and safely treated. Could potentially work, but we see this model as being as not really solving many of the root issues that have prevented new antibiotics from being developed, where it doesn't really solve those the root issues with antibiotics, and also it creates quite a few new ones where phage have their challenges. So as a company, if we were to develop a phage cocktail, manufacture it according to GMP, test it in preclinical, generally animal tests, test it for safety, and then test it for efficacy, and then submit it for marketing authorization by a competent authority, a process that usually costs somewhere around $1 billion, and then market it to patients and keep an eye on it through pharmacovigilance, through phase 4 safety testing. We would end up spending 10 to 15 years, spending $1 billion to make a product that we could expect to rapidly lose relevance. Perhaps it might not even remain relevant at the end of those 10 to 15 years, as genetic drift in bacterial populations changes the phage sensitivity of the bacteria that are ailing patients 15 years later. But also our goal would be to be, what we'd be promising to our investors is that we'd be applying this product widely, selling many, many copies of our product, which would then be performing quite active selection for phage resistance. Very quickly, if we were indeed to be quite successful, we would be selecting very strongly for phage resistance in the pathogens that are ailing patients. And so, the bacteria that are ailing patients would have a very keen interest in developing resistance to our cocktail, and they would, just like for antibiotics. And so we'd invest all of this money, invest all of this time, and end up with a product that physicians quite naturally would be obliged by circumstance to not prescribe to patients, except when it's absolutely necessary to engage in phage stewardship, just like they currently engage in antibiotic stewardship, which quite naturally will lead to us not selling the product, not recouping that $1 billion of costs, and failing as a company. The idea for a cocktail model of phage therapy would be to make a cocktail, sell that to patients, and then you would need to make a new cocktail at some point. Maybe that's 6 months later, maybe that's 12 months later, maybe that's even 5 years later, but in a process that takes 10 to 15 years, where every medical product that's provided to patients must be tested for safety and efficacy, that long, expensive process. And so how sustainable would it really be to do this as often as would really be necessary? We see this as a trap for a company, just like currently antibiotic development is a trap for companies. It's a way to lose money and not help anyone. And so in contrast, we are working on what we call the European model for phage therapy. So in contrast to the conventional medicinal product development pipeline, we're using a much more traditional tailor-made approach that has existed for far longer than what's now the conventional approach. So in our approach, we develop a regularly updated bank of quality-controlled, small-scale produced phage stocks. No, so this is a bank of phage that is likely to have at least one phage that will be active against any clinical isolate that a patient will come into the clinic with. This bank of phage is then tested against the patient's clinical isolate with a diagnostic to identify which phages the patient actually needs. Once one or more phage is identified as being appropriate for this patient, active pharmaceutical ingredient, the phage API, is then sent to a hospital pharmacist who then formulates it into whichever form a patient happens to need, whether that's a preloaded syringe or a cream or a liquid preparation. And that's then provided to a physician who applies the phage. So the key difference is that when phage resistance ensues, as it will, we will then be able to take the bacteria that are resistant to our phage, or at least that are not susceptible to our phage library, collect them, bring them back to our laboratory, and isolate new phages against them, and then add them into our bank and add them into our diagnostic, creating a much more epidemiologically sustainable and economically sustainable model, where instead of the phage being the core of our strategy, the phage being the product that we're developing for us, the phage are as disposable as they need to be. What we'll be testing for safety and efficacy won't be the phage exactly, it will be the ability of our diagnostic to recommend a safe and efficacious phage. And that diagnostic can sustainably adapt as the bacteria that we're attempting to target also continue to adapt around us. And so in this model, we have a large bank of phage, larger than could ever be put into a cocktail. And then each patient gets whichever specific phage from that large library that they happen to need, patient by patient, creating a personalized therapy on an individual level. A fundamentally new product for every patient. So, in contrast to the fixed medicinal products pipeline, which has a one-size-fits-all approach, where the fixed phage cocktail really can't be made to evolve without enormous amounts of very expensive work. And which has already been shown to have a high failure rate in clinical trials. We have the personalized medicine model, where in that personalized approach that includes a diagnostic to determine the optimal phage selection, it can sustainably adapt. Also allows for substantially reduced formulation challenges. Two phage, when they're mixed together, will often degrade each other, which substantially limits the number of phage that can be mixed together in a cocktail. For us, we would never need to mix more than one or two or even potentially three phages together to make a product for a patient. Also critically for our both quite old but also still quite new field, it allows for pharmacovigilance. We'll be able to keep track of how well our product is working in real time every time it's used, using our diagnostic, allowing us to continually update it. But the biggest reason why we've gone with the personalized medicine model is that almost all of the compelling evidence for phage therapy efficacy has been generated through personalized models. It's what appears to work. So in this European model for phage therapy, it starts with a phage bank of phage seed lots, characterized phage that have been demonstrated to be genomically safe. These are then manufactured in a controlled environment as active pharmaceutical ingredients, where these phage APIs are produced in advance at scale, such that they can be provided to many patients when recommended, according to the magistral monograph. They undergo external quality testing by, at the moment, a Belgian-approved laboratory, though soon this will be expanded onto a European level. And then each API, when prescribed by a physician, goes to a hospital pharmacy in order to be formulated in whichever form a patient happens to need. Phage therapy over the last 100 years has had its challenges, and I'll go through these while I describe the evidence for phage therapy as it exists today. So I'll start by talking about the case study that really convinced me that phage therapy could really work, particularly at scale. This is a case study with a single patient. And you have to keep in mind that most patients who have a serious problem with a bacteria, many of them will get better on their own with no intervention at all through the intervention of their own immune system. With any antimicrobial therapy, it's important to ask yourself, are there randomized controlled trials demonstrating that the thing that's actually helping these patients is the antimicrobial product, which I'll get to in a bit. But this case study includes a historical control, which I found quite convincing. This was an elderly patient with severe sepsis, severe abdominal sepsis. That was secondary to a substantial hernia that he had that was strangling his bowels. So this patient was a frequent flyer in Belgian hospitals, having had a very prolonged hospital course that was complicated by gangrene. This was a man in pretty substantial trouble. Now, he had his lower limbs, by the time he got to the Queen Astrid Military Hospital, already amputated and was already developing a large necrotic pressure source. So that will be on the next slide if you're sensitive to images that keep that in mind. That will be the next slide. So 3 months after admission, this patient was transferred to the Queen Astrid Military Hospital for surgical management of those pressure sores, which by that point had already been infected by multi-drug resistant Pseudomonas aeruginosa. So by 1 month after admission, this patient had developed septicemia from the Pseudomonas aeruginosa, which at that time was only sensitive to colistin, a quite harsh antibiotic. And he was on intravenous colistin therapy that at that time was keeping him alive, managing that septicemia. However, this is that pressure sore that was the source of the Pseudomonas infection. A man with a very serious problem. But the colistin therapy was, while it was saving his life, it was also killing him, causing substantial kidney damage. By this point he was in a quite deep coma, and his family had a choice to make, realistically, where they could allow him to stay on the colistin therapy, and which would cause him to die of kidney failure, or they could take him off of the colistin therapy, causing him to die of the septicemia. The death from septicemia would have been faster and not quite as brutal, and so they opted for that. And so they opted to take him off of the colistin, at the same time they opted to put him on intravenous phage therapy in the hopes that that would then manage his septicemia, saving his life. And so to avoid that intensive interventions that were certain to kill him potentially save his life, bacteriophage therapy was initiated. And this is what happened. So the IV colistin therapy was stopped, which then caused the septicemia to quite rapidly return. So you can see after just 3 days, his body temperature went up as a fever in response to the septicemia. His serum creatine went up also in response to the septicemia. But the moment, and 7 Pseudomonas aeruginosa positive blood cultures were taken. This is a man in very serious trouble. But the moment that the IV bacteriophage therapy was initiated, his body temperature went down, his serum creatine levels, a measure of that septicemia, went down, his CRP levels, a measure of the systemic inflammation in his body, began to go down. And he was in his blood, Pseudomonas aeruginosa was no longer detectable, indicating that the phage therapy, in the absence of any antibiotic therapy, really did save this man's life. So, but again, this is a case study. It's not a randomized controlled trial. Will indeed really be necessary. So I will discuss now several randomized controlled trials that have been conducted over the last 80 years. So you can, first I'll discuss two historical ones that are discussed in this manuscript, Phage Treatment of Human Infections. So the first mass application of phage therapy was conducted by the Soviet Union during the Winter War with Finland in 1947. That was then reported in 1947, where soldiers were given phage against the bacteria that caused gangrene prophylactically. More than 5,000 soldiers in the experimental group and nearly 8,000 soldiers in the control group in another battalion. We're provided a placebo to see, okay, who gets more gangrene. And indeed, substantially larger number of soldiers in the control group got gangrene, indicating the efficacy of this historical phage therapy preparation. But again, but this product, no longer exists. And so this is an indication that perhaps phage therapy can work, but it's not an indication that we can make phage therapy work. In the 1960s, another large test of phage therapy was conducted in Old Tbilisi against dysentery in children. Neighborhoods were split up with the control group on one side of the street and the experimental group on the other side of the street, providing each with either a placebo or a phage preparation designed against dysentery that enrolled more than 30,000 children. And in the trial, they were able to show a greater than 3.8-fold decrease in the incidence of dysentery with phage treatment. And similar follow-up trials with also astonishingly large numbers of children enrolled also replicated this effect. But again, this product also doesn't really exist anymore. So it's an indication that phage therapy was able to work, but not an indication that it works today, particularly in the modern Western pharmaceutical environment. This is a more rigorous analysis of the phage case studies that have been performed in the modern era, where in this large number of case studies, clinical improvement was able to be seen in over 80% of patients and bacterial eradication in over 90% of patients treated with phage therapy, at least when that therapy was personalized. And so this is also an indication that, maybe this can be made to work, but the real challenge that we have today is for a company able to make a product that can be applied in routine to make that product safe and efficacious. So there have been a few attempts at this over the last few years in the modern era. Now, starting with Wright et al. And Biocontrol in the UK. So this was a phase 1-2 trial using Pseudomonas phage against otitis media, a swimmer's ear. A Pseudomonas infection that generally you get when you are swimming in natural environments. And they were able to show that phage therapy was in this trial safe, but it was too small to really demonstrate efficacy. It could only It did seem to work, but it was too small, not sufficiently powered to demonstrate efficacy. The next trial was conducted by Nestle in Bangladesh against infant coliform diarrhea. So this manuscript presented the first controlled trial in the modern era properly powered to assess efficacy, that was large enough to assess the efficacy of the preparation. And it also, at least at the beginning, appeared to be our field's first major failure to demonstrate efficacy, where it sought to use two different E. coli phage preparations to treat infant coliform diarrhea in Bangladesh, and neither preparation could be observed to produce a clinical benefit in these patients. However, due to the elegant design of the trial, additional later work was able to demonstrate that the phage preparations did appear to actually work. They did treat E. coli. It's just that E. coli did not cause disease in these patients. Where it seemed to further work was able to, I think, quite convincingly demonstrate that, unlike what has been thought for the last 140 years since Robert Koch, the beginnings of microbiology, unlike what we've thought for so long that, diarrhea where you can isolate E. coli is mediated by that E. coli. At least in this context, in this patient population, that wasn't in fact the case. E. coli was just a marker of disease. Where the causative agent of disease was Streptococcus. And so by providing these patients with E. coli phage, it didn't actually treat the disease. There was no clinical benefit. Which to me is a very powerful lesson for us, where phage, if we're not careful, phage will make fools of us all. Where before starting a phage therapy project, it will be essential to be very clear that that there's a connection between the bacteria that we're targeting, because phage are so specific, unlike antibiotics, that there's a clear connection between the bacteria that we're targeting and either the etiology or the symptoms of disease, which was not the case here. And then the next clinical trial, which has also been often presented as a failure for our field, was the Fogelburn trial. So in this trial, they manufactured 20 different phage to create an astonishingly large cocktail. Which swallowed the almost the entirety of the budget for the trial. 12 phage over the course of 20 months were manufactured, which was not enough time to manufacture these phage. And really properly demonstrate the stability of these phage when mixed together. And when they were mixed together, these phages degraded each other. And so what was provided to the patients in the end was essentially just saline. And also due to the complicated nature of the burn wounds that were being treated in this trial, physicians were quite reluctant to include patients. This was a product that only included phages that infect Pseudomonas, but patients with burn wounds are often infected with many things with a very polymicrobial wound. And so a physician with a patient whose life they were responsible for was then presented with the choice of either leaving them on the antibiotic that may or may not work, but would at least be working on all of the bacteria ailing this patient, or taking an experimental product that may or may not work only on one bacteria. And few physicians were willing to do that. And so the trial was substantially underpowered because it was unable to recruit sufficient patients. A retrospective, because they didn't have enough time in order to do phage susceptibility testing in advance to demonstrate that their cocktail actually hit the strains that the patients actually had, a retrospective analysis then demonstrated that many of the Pseudomonas strains that patients were infected with were not susceptible to the phage in the cocktail. And as I mentioned, what the patients were provided with in the end in fact, did not include very much phage at all, because they didn't have time to demonstrate the stability of their cocktail. So at these very low concentrations, phage did decrease the bacterial burden in burn wounds, but not nearly as well as the standard of care, a silver sulfadiazine cream. Now, indicating that, yes, the standard of care was substantially superior, at least to the product that they were able to make. Now, the next most recent trial, the TERP trial conducted in Tbilisi, Georgia, was treating urinary tract infections during surgery, during transurethral resection of the prostate. So in this trial, they sought to use Georgian pyophage as part of bladdering irrigation during a transurethral resection of the prostate to prevent infection. And what they ended up finding was that the placebo treatment, just washing the prostate during this procedure, was substantially more effective than they anticipated, which disrupted their power calculations. Now, their phage preparation, as far as they could tell, was just as effective as the placebo treatment in the statistics that they were able to do. But this was likely because the trial wasn't large enough to be able to see the small differences between the phage treatment and the placebo treatment, because the placebo treatment was just much more effective than they anticipated. They needed a larger trial. And so really this trial was inconclusive. And so in summary, the first otitis media trial did indeed appear to work, but was not sufficiently statistically powered to really properly demonstrate the efficacy of phage therapy. The E. coli infant diarrheal trial failed to demonstrate efficacy because they were treating the wrong bacteria. The Fogelburn trial also failed to demonstrate efficacy, at least in part because they weren't actually treating these patients with phage. They were treating them with what was essentially saline. And the most recent TERP trial was inconclusive. Really just demonstrating that this is producing phage products and testing phage therapeutic efficacy is a hard problem, particularly with modern expectations about the demonstrations of efficacy. So now I'll also like to at least briefly discuss what we do as a company. So I already showed this slide where in contrast to fixed medicinal products, we are working with this personalized medicine model. But to do the personalized medicine model, we need to be able to personalize the treatment, which requires a phagogram, some diagnostic step that identifies which of our phage are able to infect a patient's clinical isolate. But historical methods are profoundly inadequate to do this at scale, at the scale that patients need. Both plaque assays that look to see whether phage produced plaques on a clinical isolate and spot tests. For starters, these assays require far too much labor to be able to implement in routine. The work hours spent per tests are unacceptable for routine application, and also clinical microbiologists don't have phage expertise, and this would require substantial phage expertise to perform and also to interpret. They require far too much time. The population of patients who can be adequately served with more than a 72-hour delay is small indeed. When a patient has a serious bacterial problem, generally that problem will resolve either through spontaneous resolution of the problem where the patient ends up okay, or through death relatively quickly. And so for our therapy to be relevant, it needs to be able to be applied very fast. For phage therapy to be feasible and routine, a physician has to have that actionable answer in no more time than it takes to produce an antibiogram, to do antimicrobial susceptibility testing, to right now in routine practice in order to direct antibiotic therapy. And also, yeah, these historical methods are difficult to consistently interpret. If you show one of these plates to five phage biologists, you're liable to get eight different answers as to what that plate really means. And that's not acceptable. And that's with experts, which is, yeah, not something that you can teach to clinical microbiologists in for routine practice. So while we were working to design a new phagogram, one that would be truly implementable in routine therapy, we saw a number of essential factors that we needed to do. Needed to achieve. Now, our phagogram, our diagnostic would need to be feasible in every laboratory hospital, including small ones. It couldn't require expensive disposables or equipment. It needed to be accessible. It couldn't require specialized academic labor that is not present in these clinical microbiology laboratories. It can't require bulky equipment. When selling a new test to a clinical microbiology lab, the footprint of that test is essential. They don't have very much space. It needs to be user-friendly enough. It needs to be fast. Needs to be highly sensitive and specific. It needs to say what we think, what we advertise it as saying. But also the standardized results need to be clear and easily understood by clinicians, like is currently the case for antibiotics, where physicians get a report with antibiotics that the patient's clinical isolate is either sensitive, intermediate, or resistant to each antibiotic being tested. We need something like this. Where we see the functionally infinite number of possible relationships between a clinical isolate and the phages that we have as being summarizable into it being insensitive to each of our phage, where that phage would then have no relevant activity on the tested bacteria. It could be killed by that phage, but perhaps that the phage might not be able to use it to replicate. Or it could be killed and vulnerable to replication at the expense, vulnerable to the phage replicating at its expense. And so, building this phagogram, we started from first principles, going back to the basics of phage biology, where phage, as Rob Levine presented. Work in these five steps of attachment, the arrest of cell growth, converting the cell from being a cell-making factory into being a phage-making factory. They replicate their phage DNA, package that DNA into new phage particles, lyse the cell to then release 30 to 3,000 new phage, which then go on to find new bacteria to infect. And our first thought was, we could focus on step two. That would be vulnerable to detection. So the core challenge of making a phagogram is that there's a limited number of available cells to detect. Where in order to do this really in routine, we'd need to be able to have a nurse take a patient sample, whether it's a urine sample or a blood sample or a swab of the infected wound, have that swab go to the hospital's clinical microbiology lab, just like it already does for antimicrobial susceptibility testing. It gets struck out onto a plate to isolate pure culture clinical isolates, just like is currently done for antimicrobial susceptibility testing. And then the clinical microbiologist needs to be able to take a swab, pick up an individual colony that they think is causing the patient's problem, put that into a robot, and then the robot does the rest. Within 2 to 4 hours, like is currently the case for antimicrobial susceptibility testing. We see the need to create phage susceptibility testing that fits within those parameters, to not have to invent new wheels. Which means that we need to be able to perform tests against many phage from a single colony, and a single colony is not going to contain enough cells to be able to visually or optically detect. So our thinking was, what if instead of detecting phage infection, we allowed the diluted patient clinical isolate to exist in the presence of each phage independently, And then we wait to see if that bacteria is able to grow to a density that we could detect. So instead of detecting phage infection, we detected the growth of uninfected cells. So, and then look to see which phage prevented growth. So instead of detecting sensitivity, detecting resistance, and from the absence of resistance, inferring sensitivity. Now, but this had severe limitations. It could only be performed on pure culture isolates. No, if there were other bacteria mixed in there, they would also be resistant to the phage. And so we would also falsely infer sensitivity from the absence of resistance by non-target bacteria. It would require an additional 18 hours, which patients do not have. It'd require a bulky and expensive robot, which wouldn't be implementable in routine on site, which means that we'd have to create a small number of core facilities that clinical microbiology labs would need to ship a patient's strain to, creating even more delays, requiring a functional minimum of a week, realistically 2 to 3 weeks before an actionable result, which patients definitely do not have time for. So instead, we went with step 5, detecting the lysis and release of cell contents. And so within every bacterial cell, there is ATP, which is the battery of the cell, which can power enzymes. So taking the luciferase enzyme, the same kind of enzyme that causes the rear ends of fireflies to glow during summer. That enzyme is powered by ATP. And so by mixing the patient's clinical isolate after being mixed with phage with the luciferase enzyme, we're able to detect the ATP that's released by phage-mediated lysis. So now, what does this mean really in routine practice? So this is a phage plate. So this is a lawn of bacteria that has a phage spotted onto it in serial dilutions. And this is a plate where if you show it to 5 different phage biologists, you'll get one answer as to what it means. So this up here at the top with phage red, on the right is a lytic spot. So that's a high concentration of phage put onto this lawn of bacteria. And that high concentration of phage is killing all of the bacteria, indicating that this phage is lethal on this clinical isolate. And then at the higher dilutions, the lower concentrations of phage, you see individual plaques. So that's a single phage that's replicating at the expense of the bacteria, creating that plaque, indicating that the phage red is truly replicating at the expense of this bacteria. Phage blue is doing the same, whereas phage green is doing nothing at all. This is a bacteria that's insensitive to phage green. And so here on the right, you can see after we incubate each phage red, phage blue, and phage green with this patient's clinical isolate, ATP is released by phage-mediated lysis after mixing with phage red and phage blue. Released over time, indicating phage replication, whereas nothing is happening with phage green, indicating that our test performs like the reference assay, which is what we'd hoped it did. It do. And then here you can see a plate that if you were to show it to 5 phage biologists, you'd be liable to get 12 answers as to what it means. Phage red is producing a very clear lytic spot, indicating very good killing and very big, beautiful plaques, indicating that it's really properly able to replicate at the expense of this clinical isolate. Whereas phage green and phage blue there's maybe some toxicity there, but it's clearly not able to properly replicate at the expense of this bacteria. But what is it doing exactly? Well, our assay shows you. So on the right, you can see after mixing for 30 minutes, the length of time it takes for the phage infection to happen, ATP is released along with new phage particles, daughter phage particles from those phage-infected cells, which then go on to infect more cells within the culture, which then go on to release more ATP, indicating that, yes, this phage is truly replicating at the expense of this clinical isolate, whereas phage green and phage blue are binding to cells, killing those cells, but not replicating at their expense. It's working like an antibiotic at the around the minimum inhibitory concentration. And you can see on the bottom graph, you know, that phage blue and phage green aren't able to control the culture, aren't likely to produce a plausible clinical benefit, whereas phage red is in fact clearing that culture and would be capable of producing a plausible clinical benefit. So how we've constructed our assay being able to detect a percentage of the culture that our phage is able to lyse after 60 minutes, enough time for two rounds of infection. And so because we're adding very few phage and very many relative to the number of bacteria that we're adding into each test of each phage, we only see the lysis of a substantial proportion of the culture if the phage is able to truly replicate at the expense of the bacteria. And so if we see a percentage of lysis higher than 50, that consistently reflects the production of plaques. If it's between 20% and 50%, that consistently reflects a potentially clinically meaningful toxicity. No. And if it's below 20%, that consistently reflects the absence of meaningful, plausible clinical benefit from giving a patient this phage. And so we're able to, with this test, with a large number of phage, very rapidly assess whether each of our phage is able to infect a patient's clinical isolate. And this changes the game. This allows personalized phage therapy to be implemented in routine at scale. So in contrast to the old methods, which are manual intensive laboratory work that can't be implemented, requires far too much time, could only be feasible in a core facility that patients would need to ship their bacterial isolates to, requires substantial preparatory work, and really would be more appropriate for pre-designed cocktails. Our semi-automatic phagogram has an easy automated process. It can be used on with up to 92 phage all at once in a multiplex fashion. It's accessible to any hospital laboratory that can currently implement antimicrobial susceptibility testing, requires no preparatory work, and is appropriate for personalized cocktails. So with that, I'd like to thank each of you for listening. And encourage you, if you find this interesting, to contact me at my email address here, bob.blasdel@phage.health. If I can send my slides to everyone, there's a link to a number of Ukrainian phage biologists talking about phage work currently being performed in Ukraine. So this is an hour-long presentation in Clubhouse. I think you'll need to download the Clubhouse app in order to be able to listen to it. Every Friday, there is the Phage Fridays Clubhouse meeting, where we discuss, a group from around the world discusses phage biology from a different perspective every Friday. That might also be interesting for you.
Okay.
I guess I'd like to open it up for questions you might have.
Yes, we have some questions for you. And may I ask you firstly, as I understand, phage cocktail is more personalized medicine than phage band. Mm-hmm. Am I right?
So in our model for phage therapy, it is truly personalized, where every patient will get a unique mixture of phage that is made specifically for them.
Okay, that means that phage bank, the sum of some phages that can prepare before the therapy.
Yes.
Standard. But do you know maybe about some experiments when we, or someone, compare this phage cocktail and phage bank for the one pathogen? Do you know about this?
At least in vitro, when a large number of active phage are provided, are mixed with a patient's clinical isolate. Now, that works around as well as a single phage, so long as it works on that single phage also works on that patient's clinical isolate. But when you see, when you look for the development of resistance, that clinical isolate will develop resistance to the cocktail around as quickly to the cocktail as it would to a single phage within that cocktail. Now, mm-hmm. But if you were to add, expose that, then if you were to add a single phage to that clinical isolate and then wait for resistance and that then add another phage, it would then need to gain resistance independently to that next phage, allowing the therapy to be substantially more sustainable.
Mm-hmm. It's a difference in the period of time of the of this treatment, yes.
So there are patients with very chronic infections where you could expect them to require phage therapy for long periods of time, where a cocktail would be unlikely to be able to be relevant for the entire period of time that the patient would need it.
And it is connected with this antibiotic resistance situation.
Yes.
Okay, we have some more questions from our participant. First of them, how the phage therapy could work for burn infections, despite they usually, as you said, multi-infectional nature?
So in a burn wound, depending on the way that that burn wound is being treated, there's two different ways, the wet method and the dry method. With the dry method, patients tend to get Staph aureus and other gram-positive infections, and it's often a mix. Now, or with the wet method, they tend to get gram-negative infections, including Staph aureus, Klebsiella, E. coli. It's often a mix of things. And so if you were to imagine yourself to be a physician with a patient with one of either kind of a burn wound treated in either way, and you had a phage cocktail that only hit one of those bacteria that the patient had, you wouldn't expect to see very much clinical benefit at all. Where you'd need, in order to provide clinical benefit to this patient, you'd need to add phage that would be effective against a large number of the bacteria that they had in their wound in order to sanitize the wound and allow for healing to take place, allowing the wound to close and then be sustainably resistant to reinfection. And so, burn wounds are going to be a difficult problem for phage therapy to solve because it's not one problem. It's going to necessarily be many problems that would all need to be solved simultaneously. And so for us as a company, we're not focused on burn wounds as an initial indication. We're focused, at least at the beginning, on easier problems where the infection is ideally monoclonal. But we see phage therapy as being able to treat more polymicrobial wounds where more than one bacteria is causing the problem in the future once the field develops well enough to be able to make products that could be expected to be effective against those more complex wounds.
Okay, thank you, Asi. One more question. Thank you very much for such amazing lecture. What are the biggest advantages or disadvantages of bacteriophage therapy in your opinion?
So there are a number of big advantages and also a number of big disadvantages. So for advantages, I'll just start with those. I'm a phage biologist. Now, phage can be the mechanisms of both antibiotic resistance and antibiotic persistence are largely independent of mechanisms of phage resistance and phage persistence. And so it's a therapeutic model that's quite synergistic with antibiotic therapy. They're not necessarily in opposition, but for patients for whom antibiotics are ineffective, phage can be effective. And for patients for whom phage are ineffective, antibiotics could be. And so both will improve the sustainability of each other. But also phage are able to replicate in situ. And so there are a large number of patients for whom who have deep infections where their circulatory system is unable to deliver effective concentrations of antibiotic deep enough into the site of infection to cure the patient, perhaps they can manage the infection, prevent the infection from becoming systemic and septic. But they'll never really cure the patient. Because to give a high enough concentration of the antibiotic to reach the deepest parts of the infection at a high enough concentration, that go well beyond the toxicity of the antibiotic. But with phage, you only really need a few phage, a very small number of phage, to reach the infection. And then they amplify in situ towards the deepest reaches of the infection and are able to have a very different relationship to pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. They could be effective in a lot of patients in which antibiotics simply are not. Another big advantage is their safety profile. With antibiotics, we've been unable to ethically test many antibiotics in pediatric patients because we know they have harms, and doing that testing can only be ethically done if you're reasonably sure that you're not going to be causing harm to the study population. And so particularly for pediatric patients, especially young children and pregnant women, that physicians then have these terrible judgment calls when their patients have infections. They have to use medical products that have never been properly tested, even for safety in these patients. Whereas with phage, their safety profile is much better. And so we see, particularly for infants, young children, and pregnant women, phage is having this very large safety advantage. But for disadvantages, phage are complicated. They're difficult to understand. We're only really just beginning to have a good concrete understanding of a lot of the aspects of phage that we'll need in order to provide consistently safe and consistently efficacious treatments. Phage degrade faster than most antibiotics. The CEO of one of the contract manufacturing organizations in our field, Frank Smrecker, who runs Jafrol, who likes to say in his presentations that phage stability is not boring, like a lot of academics might. And phage are, in a lot of contexts, quite unstable. Especially relative to many antibiotics is a profound disadvantage. And they're quite specific, which is also an advantage in that they will have few off-target effects, but it makes them complicated to be able to apply efficaciously.
Okay, thank you very much. And one more question. What is the more effective way, for your opinion, to find a specified phage against defined bacteria through the artificial modeling from start or by the correcting with molecular biology approaches a naturally occurred phage?
At least in my opinion, I'm at heart a microbiologist. In Rob's lab, I learned molecular biology and sort of pretended to be a molecular biologist. During my master's, I sort of pretended to be an evolutionary biologist. But really, in my perspective, when you have a functional question and you need a functional answer, whether or not this phage is efficacious against this bacteria, or this phage has advantageous properties for therapy, the only way to ask that question is with a functional assay. Otherwise, you're trying to predict something. Your prediction is going to rely on assumptions, not all of which you'll even be really aware of. Whenever you're making theoretical predictions, you're always going to run into issues that you won't see until it's too late. Particularly during product development. So I'm really a big fan of isolating phage with good functional assays, selecting phage with good functional assays, and then validating them with good functional assays.
Okay, thank you. One more question. Mm-hmm. What are the technologies of interaction with phage and obtaining commercial available products are you planning to start or maybe apply in the nearest time?
The diagnostic that we developed is one of these technologies that we're going to be applying both for isolating and selecting phages, but also targeting them to individual patients. But we use sequencing, we use in silico annotation, we use a variety of multiplexed assays in order to assess phage at scale.
Okay, thank you very much. And one more question. Ukrainian pediatricians often prescribe bacteriophage to breastfeeding mother to treat a child. How efficient is this? How do you think?
This I wasn't aware of. I could see this being something that could work. Thinking as a corporate person developing products, I'd want to see data demonstrating that however the phage was being applied to the mother was able to access her bloodstream in order to be able to spread systemically within the mother, then able to cross the breast barrier to end up in the breast milk, remain stable in the breast milk and end up in effective concentrations in the breast milk. And then also demonstrate that the phage was making it into the infant at effective concentrations, and that it was effective if the phage was being applied to treat intestinal problems, that it was arriving in the intestines at effective concentrations, or if it was intended to treat more systemic problems, that it was crossing the gut barrier in the infant as well in order to be able to spread systemically within the infant. And also that the phages that were in the preparation being provided to the mother were targeted towards bacteria or multiple bacteria that were indeed the causative agents of either the symptoms or etiology of disease in the infant. So it really doing this, I would see as a very difficult development problem to really do in a rigorous way. But I would see it as having plausible success so long as the product was developed appropriately. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't, but I guess I'd need to have data on the product to be able to make a guess.
Yes, okay. And one more question. What source do you recommend to learn more about this topic? I think it is about phage therapy.
Let's see. So in my presentation, I listed the four major modern randomized controlled trials, as well as two of the major historical ones. Looking into those papers, I think, would give you a lot of insight, as well as the papers that cite those papers, would give you a lot of insight into the field. As well as if you're interested in the historical nature of the field, that first paper that I cited, phage therapy for human infections, I think is still one of the better reviews of phage therapy, at least historical phage therapy that's out today. In Google Scholar, you'll be able to find many phage reviews. It seems every phage biologist has written their own review from their own perspective. Reading a few of those will give you, I think, a relatively broad understanding of the field.
Okay, thank you very much for your report. It was very pleased and interesting to obtain so much information and especially practical information. And thank you very much.
Thank you. It's been an honor to present to you.
Thank you.
So I think we were scheduled to end at 3 p.m. or 4 p.m. Kiev time, which we're now approaching?
We in time. we are in time.